giving him advice on how to be a good king, and he's like, just, do you love me? Am I father? What is Aegon's relationship with this family like?
Well, I think that moment that you just picked out there is a good example of, you know, Aegon kind of just laughs at her when she said about those things. He didn't want it. He didn't want the responsibility. He's, you know, he confesses himself that he's not suited for it. And only really when he hears that, you know, Viserys has supposedly said that he's changed his mind and he wants you to do it, does that glimmer of hope, maybe, that, you know, there was a bit of faith in him from his father. And in answer to your question, I think the family relationship, he's always felt very sidelined, and Rhaenyra was the favourite child, and he was just sort of shoved to the side.
What's it like the first time you got into the costume, got into wardrobe, makeup, you know, the wig and everything? How did it feel?
Yeah, interesting. The main thing was the wig. That was the deal breaker right there. I'd never had to wear a wig on a job before. So for this character to be created from the floor up, which it was sort of fitting to costume and everything like that, and then any extra stuff like the swords and the dagger and, you know, everything like that, and then it got to the top where it was hair and makeup. It felt like once that wig had been decided on, I remember lots of conversations about how short we should go with it. These wigs cost so much money, so to cut it, it has to be really incremental, because you can't make it longer. But that really felt like we'd found something there when the whole thing was on and I was looking in the mirror. I didn't see me anymore, which was nice, because I really wanted to escape into Aegon as much as possible.
Have you watched any of the show now since it's aired? Are you the kind of performer who can watch yourself?
No, I'm not. I'm not by standards of set by myself. I never watched this, but I have seen House of the Dragon, and can safely say I'm a huge fan. Absolutely love it. I mean, it's brilliant.
So do you just go up to the time jump when you appear and then just stop?
Just watch my own bits. No. Watched it from the start, religiously, week by week. Me and my housemates, who were very supportive, we all sat down in the living room and turned all the lights off, lit some candles, and watched it.
How has the response been? You know, this is a story and a show and a world with a vibrant fan base, kind of like, unlike a lot of other things. What's it been like?
It's been great. The response has been overwhelming. You know, I've never experienced anything like it in my career. You know, it was great to see. I mean, we were always riding on the shoulders of giants coming into House of the Dragon, being set up by Game of Thrones, and with these amazing actors and the amazing writers that made that piece. You know, so we felt very much like, oh, we've got some boots to fill. But I'm really glad that it's had the response that it's had, and, you know, this is just the beginning. There's so far to go with it.
Speaking of those giants, you've mentioned in other interviews that Alfie Allen played Theon and Kit Harington played John, reached out to you and gave you some advice. Is there anything that you can share with us about what they told you about what this experience would be like?
Well, I recently worked with Alfie on a different project, and it was around the time that I was allowed to start telling people that, yeah, I was playing Aegon, and he was just like, he was just saying, enjoy it, just get swept away with the process, because it's such a huge machine, and you are, for something this big, you are given an amazing amount of creative control, and you know, you can really come away from work feeling fulfilled and like you've, you know, had a real impact on the story, you know, as an actor. And sometimes, you know, with things as big as this, you can kind of get swept under the carpet and sort of be told what to do. But this is such a creative, collaborative process between actors and creatives themselves.
Take us into that. What is that like, kind of, on the day you're on set, you're building out this character, you're trying to find different emotional beats. How does that collaboration work between you, the rest of the cast, Miguel, etc.?
Well, I think, you know, it's down to Kate Rhodes-James, who's the casting director, the amazing casting director for House of the Dragon. She has expertly put a bunch of actors together who just meld so well and who really want to work and to invest themselves and really dedicate themselves to these characters and this story. You know, so everyone's on the same page. There's nobody who just wants to turn up, do it, and go home. You know, everyone's so immersed in it. So to build the characters together is a dream, really, for any actor to be a part of. It's a really, like I said, it's a really collaborative and fulfilling experience.
What do you think, Aegon, is? What are you looking forward in season two for Aegon? Is there any particular, not an event? I know we can't spoil it, although I'm sure book readers have an inkling of the things that might be coming. But what are you looking forward for him?
I'm looking forward to having Aegon have a lot more meat to get his teeth stuck into and to cause more havoc, really. And just throw a spanner in the works as he does so well. So I guess.
Who do you of the characters currently going in the show? Is there any one of them that you think would actually be a good ruler? What have you been doing since rap?
I had a little bit of a break. I have a beautiful golden retriever, so I've been spending a lot of time with him. Thank you. I'll tell him that he got around with this. He'll be chuffed to bits. Thank you. I did a couple more projects, a little few. I'm on a film at the moment. I did a little TV show a while back. So just keeping busy and. But also making sure that I get some downtime as well before starting again in March for season two.
Have you been able to reconnect with any of the cast that are here yet?
The cast that are here?
Yeah.
I'm meeting all of the cast here for the first time.
Oh wow.
I've never met any of them before. Me and Dan have a few mutual friends. Podrick, absolute legend.
But, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, but obviously Alfie, I saw Alfie for dinner last night, but I've not really had a chance to say hello to anyone yet.
Oh wow, that's so cool. And of course you were in another project with Alfie, SAS Rogue Heroes, and I think that's quite good. If anybody wants to watch, it's quite good. I shouldn't plug another show.
Thanks, Jason. Thank you.
This is a show and a story with so many like iconic props, whether it's the throne, the various swords. Is there anyone in particular that struck you, that's like, you got it in your hand and you got next to it and you're like, oh, that's pretty cool. I'd like to steal that.
Blackfire. Yeah, I'll steal that. It's just quite big to steal though.
Yeah.
So I might have to take the double. Because there's two, there's one that's like it's kind of like a heavy rubber version. For when we're throwing it about and, you know, actually using it in combat. And there's a big steel, crazy, how they've made it is amazing. It's like steel wrapped into steel, which looks like the Valerian Star's stunning. I'd take one of them.
What was that moment like when you got to raise Blackfire overhead at Aegon's crowning in the Dragon Pit?
I think that was the most surreal part of the experience. The whole coronation was mind-blowing. Any fear that you see on my face as Aegon is all real. There was absolutely no acting required in that moment. It's overwhelming. It's just a huge, bigger than this place, it's just a huge, it's like an aircraft hangar with blue screen everywhere and hundreds of extras and, all the actors on the main stage as well. It was bonkers, really crazy.
If you yourself, Tom, became king of Westeros, your first program would be, what is the first things that you implement as a new ruler?
What was that?
Children fight.
Yeah, possibly. That might be number three. I think it would be. I think I'd rescue all the stray dogs.
Oh, wonderful!
Bring them in.
Beautiful. Absolutely love it. Tell us about the. You mentioned some of the VFX and interacting with that. What's it like to, obviously the dragons aren't real, spoiler for those of us who know, but...
They are. Yeah. I've seen them, they are real.
What's it like interacting with stuff in that manner?
It's interesting, it's a challenge, because you've got to use your imagination, but equally, you've got that many different things around your foot. So for example, this scene at the end of episode 9, where Olivia and myself are stood being breathed on by this huge dragon. We're staring at a big tennis ball on a stick. Some poor guy sort of like waving it like this. And we're just looking at this for eye line. But then there's two guys on cranes either side with these huge industrial wind machines that are just blowing your face off. With all the wind and the sound effects, the roaring and, people really getting into it. But I mean, it's great, I love it. It's like being a child, it's just sort of imagining and sort of bringing the story to life, and I've just never grown up, so.
I asked you backstage, but we're doing the Young Kings panel tomorrow at 11 a.m., which is exactly the same time as England, France, and the World Cup. What should we do? What do we do?
I think instead of having me on these screens, we have the England match on. And, we can still talk and do everything. It's way more interesting than my face, so.
Shall we go to audience questions? We have a mic over here on the side. And if any of you all have some questions for the latest and most recent ruler of Westeros, go ahead and step over there to the mic on the side stage. Can you line up over there? No spoilers, please. I'm going to try.
Is that to me or them?
No, it's there. Hi.
Hello. How are you doing?
What's your name?
My name's Devin.
Hi, Devin.
Visiting from Indianapolis, Indiana. Didn't expect to be the first one up here. But my question for you is, you said you follow the show. Do you watch, do you ever go on YouTube and watch any of the YouTubers and stuff that break down the episodes and analyze the characters and all that?
No.
What do you feel about that?
No, I didn't even know that was a thing. No, should I?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's really interesting. I got lots to say about you, so yeah. You might watch
it. I'm sure they do. Okay, I'll be sure to do that. Nice to meet you, Dan.
Hello there.
Hi. This is my question. If you could be any character in Game of Thrones, who will you be and why Joffrey?
Oh. And why Joffrey? Jon Snow a go. He's got such a great story arc. He goes through every peak and trough, and I think Kit plays him amazingly. I'd love to give that a go. But also Joffrey.
Hi. So Aegon has some weird qualities. In the first season, he did something in a window.
Oh, yeah.
And in the window, is there anything like that coming in the second season?
be fair, that wasn't you.
No, I thought he was just taking in the view. I don't know. I don't know if the window gets used, but I can put in a recommendation. If you want to.
Hi. How do you mentally prepare to get into Aegon's character, especially, you know, him being very, I guess, disturbed, you know, kids fighting and all those dramas.
Sure.
How what's your process of mentally getting into character for that?
It's a good question. I keep myself to myself when I'm on set. I try not to talk to anyone, because as soon as I talk to someone, I feel distracted. So there's a lot of silence and there's a lot of sort of contemplating stuff. And I probably could be better at separating the two things in my head, just my own sense of mental health. You kind of really have to go there and then push yourself to the boundaries you feel safe pushing yourself to. It's always a process. The process is constantly changing and evolving and hopefully improving. So.
Hi.
I get to take my dog on set, yes. He's a medical support dog, so he goes everywhere with me. Oh really? Oh beautiful. Oh, hello. I'm definitely coming to say hello in a minute. I've also recently bought him a pair of dragon wings. So.
YouTubers that was mentioned, so thanks.
Sorry,
man. My name is David. We're all really enjoying your performance.
Thank you.
And, my question was about your other pet, Sunfire the Golden, who we unfortunately did not see very much of in season one. No spoilers. Have they told you some of the cool stuff that you'll be doing with Sunfire? Are you looking forward to working with the Golden tennis ball and wind machines that will be Sunfire, etc.? And again, thanks a lot. So.
No, pleasure. Thank you. I'll be sure to watch your videos as well. I am looking forward to season two and the stuff to do with the dragons. Hopefully, if I am riding a dragon, I won't be riding a tennis ball. I'll be riding something a little bit more substantial. But I'm very excited. And I can't really give too much away. But
it's a great party to be riding a dragon out there.
Oh, is there?
Yes.
I'm so useless, I need to look at this. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name's Melissa. He literally took the question I was gonna ask you, so. Oh. But my other question is now, what was your favorite scene to film?
I think my favorite scene was the scene, the banquet in episode 8, where we're all around the table and Paddy Considine gives that amazing speech. As Viserys, that was pretty special. And what we don't see in the cut version that actually ended up in the show is there were a few more speeches from different characters around the table. That just everyone had their moment, and it was just such a special thing to be a part of. And then Aegon goes and ruins it. So, I think that was my favorite scene to shoot. Nice to meet you.
Hi, my name is Richard. I just had a question. So when you first found out that you're going to be on Game of Thrones, how did you tell your family and your friends, and what was that like?
I was sworn to secrecy for a long time. I just kept it all in my head for a long, long time. And then, I started to tell people, wow, like 6 months into knowing. And I don't really know how I did it. I think I just said, I've got a job that's going to be quite exciting. And my dad's a big Game of Thrones fan, so he took it very well. that was cool. Nice to meet you.
Hey Tom, my name is Mike.
Hey, Mike.
I have a question for you guys. As actors, obviously the whole greens versus blacks when you're at that banquency, how does that dynamic set in? I'm sure you guys get on well, but I imagine prepping before that scene, what's that dynamic like for you, all of you guys?
Yeah, it's a good question. I think that's what makes that scene so electric as well, is that there's that undercurrent of subtextual hatred underneath it all, you know, and even though there are, you know, we're having to be civil for the sake of the family, and although some people take notice of that, some others don't, there's definitely an undercurrent there. But, you know, us as actors, I think we respect each other in the way that we take this process, and for scenes like that where it's so visceral and so obvious, it's the elephant in the room, we kind of keep separate. The greens and the blacks keep separate for as long as they can, and then as soon as action's called, we're in it, and that's the first time we make eye contact, and it just makes it more exciting.
Hi.
Hey.
How are you? My name is Patricia Garcia, and you are my king puppy chew.
If she was Rhaenyra, what would the relationship be like between Aegon and Rhaenyra? How would they?
If you were playing Rhaenyra. Well, I mean, I don't write the scripts. The relationship would probably be the same. We'd fly away together on a dragon.
And Helena was not his choice, as you can tell, sister wife, it was sort of kind of like set up. But if Aegon had a choice of who to wife, who would you have picked as a wife?
Good question. I don't think we meet her in season one. It's a character that I've kind of invented in my own head, someone that he's met down at Fleabon. And she's a barmaid. And she
you gonna make just bastards, no wife then, or?
Nah, I'm not wife.
Hi, my name's Katie.
Hi, Katie.
Hi, so you had an amazing cast to work with. Were there any cast members you like really bonded with and like kind of made like a good friendship, or anyone you really like looked up to coming into it?
Oh yeah, all of them. We were so lucky on this project that everyone was so grounded and down to earth and just lovely, funny people, welcoming and warm. I came in very late to the process, as I'm only in episodes 8 and 9 towards the end, so you know, it felt like first day of school, I'd turned up late kind of thing. So it was very much sort of finding my feet, and everyone made it so welcoming. But I think, you know, the people I really look up to, people who've been doing it a long time, or longer than I have at least, you know, actors like Reese Ifans and Paddy Considine, and you know, Eve Best, and great actors, just to name a few. But then, you know, the younger people like Emma and Matt and Olivia, who are all doing great things. But the boys were very nice and close. Myself and Fabian Franklin plays Kristen Cole, Ewan and the twins, the Queen's Guard. Yeah, they're just very, very fortunate in that sense.
My name is Lakin, and I wanted to ask you a bit about your relationship with your next closest brother, Aemon. As children, you kind of had a bit of a bullying relationship with him, it seems, and maybe some tension about becoming king, and so just wanted to see what you think your character feels about that relationship with your brother.
I think Aegon is very aware that Aemon is a very capable warrior, someone who is far more suited to take the throne. I mean, he wants it for a start, Aegon didn't. But also, I think there's definitely a strand of envy and, I think he's envious of him. I think he wishes he was more like him. And yet, you know, Aegon has been dealt the cards that he's been dealt, and he's now got the power. So, you know, there's that to kind of go off. But it's gonna unfold and it just spirals out of control. I love this.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Heather. My question is, what was the rehearsal process like, and what was it like working with the directors?
Rehearsal process was really enlightening, actually. It's quite rare that in any sort of screen work that you get a rehearsal time. So it was great to get together with people and map the scenes out and start working out what whatever the subtext of the scene was and where the focus and where the intentions were going. So yeah, we were all very grateful for that, because then when we got on set, it was kind of a free-for-all. We were allowed to just take what we found worked in rehearsals and you know, try new things. And it's just a case of throwing everything at the wall and see what sticks. Yeah, and that's how we were fortunate enough to have the directors who really liked to work that way.
Good morning, Tom. My name is Michelle.
Hi, Michelle.
Me and my wife have been traveling to a lot of the filming locations.
Oh, yeah.
I wanted to know what your favorite filming location was, why, and what to do in that area.
Well, I only filmed in two locations. The lot at Leeds Studios in Watford, in the UK, and we went to Caceres as well, in Spain. Caceres was a stunning, absolutely beautiful place. And it's also one of those places for a location that, for this show in particular, you don't have to touch it. It's already perfect. So we were using little back streets and just boarding up windows. All we had to do, really. And the set decoration team did such a good job of that. But it was just perfect as it was. The tiled roofs and everyone in Caceres was very welcoming and accommodating as well.
Hi, my name is Jocelyn.
Hey.
I was just wondering if what would Dagon say to Daenerys at King's Landing?
What would he say to Daenerys?
Yeah.
I think they'd sit down and I think he'd pour her a glass of wine, a tankard of wine, and they'd be 3 pints deep before any conversation was had. And just ask her where it all went wrong, really, I think. And she'd ask him the same thing back.
Hi, my name's Aziz. The most important thing that happened in all of season one was the saga of the Pink Dread. Where do you weigh in on this? Was it you, or was it one of the Strongs that pulled this prank? What do you think? Because I imagine we don't actually know the answer. But.
Well, I like to think that it was Aegon who caught the pig, who dressed it up, and then made the Strongs do the dirty work. But I think it was his idea. But then, obviously, when we see later in episode 8, when the banquet, the pig is put in front of him, and that's when it's not funny anymore. And as Aegon, I kind of regretted that moment at that point.
Hi, Devin again. This is a question about your character. Do you think that Aegon's aware of those kids he has like hanging around the fighting pits?
I'm not sure that's something Aegon thinks about very much, to be honest. I'm sure he's aware that you know, the chances are he's got lots of offspring running around. But I think he's got more pressing matters to address at the moment. But yeah, there's probably in his mind somewhere, but I don't think he cares.
Hi, how you doing?
Hey.
It's really interesting to know that you didn't have watched Game of Thrones originally, and kind of once you got the role, got dove into it, so you kind of were away from the internet culture. I was just curious, and if you have to nod, you can. Did you like everything how season 8 ended of the original Game of Thrones?
The million-dollar question. This is going to be controversial. I enjoyed it. I'm sad that that's controversial. I thought, you know what? I mean, how do you finish? How do you finish an epic like that? There's always going to be, you know, a crowd of people who are left unsatisfied. There's always going to be people who are satisfied. I thought with what they had and how they did it was pretty spectacular for my taste.
Hi. In Fire and Blood, during the banquet scene, like, Aegon is like very pissed about James dancing with Elena. But in the show, it seems like Aegon doesn't really care that much, because then Aemon like turns his whole chair around and is watching the entire thing. I was just wondering what your take on what's Aegon thinking during James dancing with Elena.
Yeah. Well, we decided to go with the idea that to give Jace the attention was a victory for him. So for me to turn my chair and watch what was happening was his victory, and I didn't want to give him that victory. So, you know, the little look that he shares with me as he takes Elena away, I think, yeah, I kind of thought that was enough. I want to keep some back.
Hey, Kyle, nice to meet you here from Canada. Hope you're having a good time. You said you became a fan of House of the Dragon after watching the season. My personal favorite scene was Viserys walking through the throne room, but I'm curious, outside of your own POV, what was your favorite scene to watch for yourself?
Oh God, that's such a good question. God, there's so many. There's just so many. I love the opening of season one where the jousting and all that's going back and forth between the jousting and the birth, and this, you know, it's just chaos and there's noise and there's action and everything's a big tangled mess, and that's right at the start. It's just like, oh God, how is this going to continue? I just remember being hit pretty heavily by that as an introduction. Just made me pretty excited for what was to come. So I guess that.
How are you preparing for the upcoming battles with Sunfire, and how does King Aegon mentally approach the fact that they have to battle other dragons?
Well, I'm not really meant to talk about this because no one's seen any of it yet. All I can tell you is that we're training very hard and we are making sure that our bodies are in good enough condition to be able to maintain how strenuous season two is going to be.
Hi, my name is Katie. Just a quick question. Did you wear green on purpose or was it by accident?
Is this green?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. I'm not wearing my glasses, so I can't see.
It's a bit gray, but we'll go with it.
No, but I got green pants on. Underpants.
I was just wondering, with Aegon being such a deep and very thought-provoking character, how do you get out of that in your head once filming's done?
That's a good question. Well, sometimes it takes a while. This time it did, and I was winding a lot of my friends up, I think. It's funny when you play a character like Aegon, it's almost impossible for it not to seep into your skin in some way. So I usually try and make sure that there's 2 weeks to a month after filming something like that where I can sort of go away and be on my own and sort of shake it off and start again. But by the time you've done that, it's time to go back to season two, so may as well just live in it.
Hi, my name is Angelina.
Hey.
Hi, and I was just wondering, I know you talked about your acting process on set, but I was wondering how you prepare to become Aegon Targaryen in the first place.
Well, I think a lot of the work is done by the writers, to be perfectly honest. So much of it is already on the page, and we as actors are the vessels, sort of breathe life into that. In terms of preparation, I often like to find a playlist. I'll create a playlist of music or soundscape or just some sort of audio much stimulation that I directly connect with that character, and I just try and live in that world for a while. It just puts you in the right headspace, focuses the mind, and makes you feel like you're dropping into something else rather than me walking around as Tom all day. You can drop into something else and live in that for a little while. So that's something I like to do. Music's a very strong part of my process.
Hi, my name is Sean. At the coronation, Aegon's already sort of going through this realization of the power he's gaining from what Allison's told him and the dagger, and just in the moment, the ceremony, what do you think's affecting him more? He seems to kind of like, all right, maybe this is so cool, like, is it the audience cheering him on? Or his realization he has this power over his family members? What made him buy into it? Did he buy into it?
I think you've just answered your own question. I think it's both. I think, that whole realization, because obviously they've got us back to the audience for the first part, it's that acknowledging of everybody there, feeling that for the first time, feeling the authority over them all. And it's really that moment where Otto gives him a nod and he turns around, and you feel like Aegon breathe the crowd in, and it's just that injection of sort of lawlessness and power that is dangerous. What's that phrase? I always paraphrase it. You can't tame it. Something about taming a dog once you put a crown on its head. What is that phrase?
I think that might be an English phrase.
No, it's from Game of Thrones.
Oh, is it?
It's from Game of Thrones. Anyone?
Huh?
Anyway, yeah, nah.
Hey, Tom. Hey. My name's JP. What's your dog's name?
Ziggy. Oh, his name is Ziggy. Oh. After Ziggy Stardust.
Oh,
yeah.
That's great.
Nice to meet you.
Last one.
What was your favorite death scene in the original Game of Thrones series?
Favorite death scene?
Ooh.
Oh my
God. The Red
Wedding. That was a good one. That was a good one.
Deception.
Got this. I think probably the most shocking one was the death of Sean Bean's character. And I just came out and went, oh my God, he's gone. I'm still stunned now.
Hi, Tom.
Hey.
My name is Vanessa, and I just wanted to say thank you for being here. I am celebrating my 25th birthday today.
Happy birthday!
I did want to ask, when you are watching back your scenes, are you able to just enjoy, or are you very judgmental of like your acting?
Yeah, no, I can't watch it as an independent observer. I'm constantly pulling my performance to pieces. I don't know. I'm just not the sort of person that can watch myself and go, I can't even bear the sight of me on that screen. it pulls me out of it. It makes me think, sometimes it makes me think next time I'm going to be on set, I'm going to be remembering what I saw and picturing it, having a third eye and just sort of being a little bit too analytical, and that just completely takes you out of it. So. No. Anyway.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for the... Oh, one more?
Sorry.
It's also my birthday.
Happy birthday.
30, all the way from New York City. Hi, Tom.
Hey.
Last question for you. Do you get to watch the show before it gets released? And do you guys film scenes that probably won't be on the show, just to kind of trick you guys as well, so spoilers don't happen?
If we do, I wasn't aware of that. So either I've not been paying attention or they didn't do that. No, I'm not aware of them adding extra scenes, but that's a good idea. I think if I make any hiccups in any of this sort of stuff, they might do that next time. But no, I'm not aware of that. Huh?
I said don't die this season.
I'll do my best.
Hi, my name is Kristen, and just to say that it's hard to leash a dog when you put a crown on his head and Tyrion said it.
Thank you.
Thanks for all the great questions. Let's get a quick poll of the audience. Applause for Team Green. Applause for Team Black. Tom Glynn-Carney, everyone.
I think that's an English play.
Ooh.
Does France meet its Waterloo?
Does France meet its Waterloo tomorrow? England v. France.
We're gonna win. We're gonna win, but nothing to worry about. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Do I dire wolf this way or that one?
This is the photo ops, so yeah.
Perfect.
And you're not allowed to take the camera inside.
Oh, got it.